Welcome to this tutorial. In this video, I'll show you how to generate levels at runtime for multiplayer games based on the player input or play style. Imagine you are playing Fall Guys and the player who reached the finish lines first gets to choose the next level from a list. Or picture another game where players explore the level, find items for their inventory to solve puzzles, and the first player to solve the puzzle picks the next level. In this tutorial, we'll start with the third person template. Now let's go ahead and give this project a name. We won't need any starter content, so feel free to skip that and make sure to select Blueprint. Once you are ready, click on Create. The first thing we need to do is enable the Procedural Level Generator plugin. You can find the link to the plugin in the description below. After enabling it, go ahead and restart the engine to add the plugin to the project. Let me show you some text overlays I've added to the video. This will help you understand whether the logic I'm working on is running on the server or the client machine. As a good habit for new projects, I always like to change the editor settings to open assets in the main window. It makes things a lot easier. Next, create a new player controller blueprint. Keep in mind, when working on multiplayer projects, your RPC, remote procedure call functions should be tied to a player controller. This can be done either by calling them directly in the player controller class, or if you are calling functions on another actor, its instigator should be a controller class. In other words, it needs to be owned by a controller. Now open the third person template game mode class and set the player controller class to the one we just created. Also, don't forget to check your levels board settings and make sure the correct game mode is selected. Let's start by setting up the UI. First, we'll create a base widget class to display the available levels to the player. For this widget, I'll start with an overlay as the base, and then add a horizontal box for the buttons. I'll call this levels list and make sure it's set as a variable so we can access it later in the blueprint graph. Next, we need another widget class to serve as the base for our buttons. This time, I'll create it using a different menu, just to show you that in Unreal Engine, or game development in general, there is usually more than one way to do things. Similar to the previous widget, this one will also start with an overlay as the base. Then, I'll add a size box to give the button a default minimum size. After that, we'll add the actual button itself. And finally, the text for the button. For the minimum size, I'll set the button to 220 pixels. From there, we can give the button a more meaningful name and a style to fit our design. I think we can set the button to black by default and display it as an image. To enhance its look, we'll reduce the opacity a bit. For the hovered state, I'll do the same thing but with higher opacity, so the player can feel the change when the mouse is over the button. Again, we'll display it as an image. Lastly, for the pressed state, we'll follow the same approach but increase the opacity even more to give a clear visual feedback when the button is clicked. Next, I'll update the text name. I'll set a default value for the text and make sure it's marked as a variable so we can easily access it from the blueprint. If you take a look at the button, you'll notice that it's already set as a variable by default. Now that the design is finished, let's move over to the graph. First, we need a variable to store the level name, and its type can be set to name. Next, we'll create another variable to store the seed, just in case we want to use a custom seed for each level. To keep things organized, I'll move both variables into a category. Make sure they are instance editable and set to expose and spawn, so we can assign them values at the time of creation. Now we need to update the button's text as soon as it's created. For that, use the setText function and the btnText and set it to the level name. To get notified when the button is clicked, I use the unreleased events, but feel free to use any other button events if needed. To pass this click event to the level selector widget, I'll create an event dispatcher. This allows us to bind a function from the level selector to the button. The event dispatcher will also need to pass along the level name stored on the button as well as the seed value. Once the mouse is released on the button, we'll call the event and use our stored variable as inputs. Let's go back to the level selector widget. We'll need a new function to create the level buttons. As inputs, we'll need two things, the levels and the seeds. While I could use a TMAP to pair these together, since TMAP isn't supported for networking, we'll pass the values as arrays instead. I'll set up a loop to go through the level names. And for each one, I'll create a UMG widget. We'll set the class to the button class we just created, and we can directly assign the level and seed here. To keep the graph cleaner and reduce unnecessary wiring, I'll promote this to a local variable. First, we'll add the button to the levels list we created earlier by calling addChild to horizontal box. Next, we need to bind the unlevel selected event dispatcher that we set up before. Use the create event node to automatically generate and bind a function to the event. Let's call this function unlevel selected. Finally, I add a bit of padding to the button for spacing. The sequence node will handle these steps in order for us, one by one. Now that our UI is ready, let's test it out. Open the level blueprint and add the begin play event. Next, add the create widget node and select the level selector menu we just made. We'll need to add this menu to the viewport. After that, grab the first player controller to set the input mode to the menu widget. And then we can enable the mouse cursor on the player controller. Finally, once the setup is complete, we can call the create level buttons function. I'll store the level names in the level blueprint, whether you prefer to call them puzzles or levels. It doesn't really matter, it's up to you. The type should be name, but I'll switch it to a TMAP since it's easier to manage, with the value type set to integer. Let's go ahead and add some test levels. You can add as many as you want, and your code will automatically create a button for each one. I'll also assign some random integers to act as the seeds. Since we need to pass the levels and seeds as arrays, we can use the keys node to get the level names as an array. And the values node to retrieve the seeds assigned to each level. I almost forgot, we need to enable the mouse cursor. Let's head back to the level selector menu and print out the name of the selected level to verify everything is working. So far, things are working great, and our UI is almost complete. Now back to the level blueprint, we can remove them, we don't need them. Let me pause the video to adjust the level, so it fits better with what we are about to build. Welcome back, our level is ready. So let's move the player SR to its proper location, and duplicate it to allow more players to join. Next, we'll add trigger boxes to the level. The first player to reach them will get to choose the next level type. Let me quickly adjust the location and size of the trigger boxes, and we'll be good to go. I'm planning to include 3 different puzzles in this level. I'll also rename them to make it easier to work with. Next, I need to add the level generators. I've already tested their locations off camera, so now I'll just place them in their proper spots. Now that everything is in place, I'll rename the level generators just like I did with the triggers. Select the first trigger, go to the level blueprint, and create a reference to it. Then search for the actor begin overlap event. We'll need 2 more of these events for the other triggers at our level. Next, I'll create a custom event for each trigger, so they will activate whenever an actor overlaps with them. Let's add the switch has authority node, since this overlap event should only trigger on the server. Let me make some space here. The rest of the logic will be the same for all the triggers, so we can create a function to handle it. I could move the authority check into the function as well, but for now, let's skip that step. The first input for the function will be trigger box. I want to unbind all events from it, so it won't trigger this function again. The other solution is to just disable its collision. The second input will be the player controller. As I mentioned earlier, it's the best place to call our RPC functions. First, we'll validate the player controller. And then cast it to our custom player controller class. Even though the casting has its own internal validation, I like to add my own validation as a good practice. The next input will be the generator class we want to use to build the level. After that, we'll add the level's dmap as an input, which will be displayed to the player. Now head back to the event graph and let's call our new function. First, connect the trigger box. The overlapped actor is the trigger class itself, while the other actor is the one that entered the trigger box. Luckily for us, there is a function to get its owning controller. We can't connect it directly because it's using the base controller class. I'll update our function input type to the base controller class and change its name for clarity. Next, we'll connect the generator. To save time, let me bring all the generators at once. Finally, we'll connect the last input, which is the level's dmap. I make some space here as we need to call the same function again for the next generator. I'll create a new levels list for this generator. But I'm getting an error because I forgot to connect the tmap. Let's fix that and add the last function. We need one more levels list. I also changed the input name, which caused this node to become invalid. Let's go ahead and remove it completely, and instead we'll rely on the cast node for validation. I'd like to add some variations to the level names. For each level generator, I want multiple options of the same type. For example, two variations of the jungle. Just make sure the shared part of the name stays consistent. Before this video gets too long, I'll wrap it up here. Make sure to watch the next part of the tutorial, where things get even more exciting. I hope this video was helpful. Be sure to check out my Monday Market Day program, where I review marketplace assets every week. I am also thinking of updating the format to fit the FAB platform. Stay tuned.